Juliet Blake brought the book to me. I heard about the book. We thought it would be a fantastic thing to partner with DreamWorks. The idea of being able to work with Steven again, I'd always carried that inside myself, just to do anything. You know, when I was auditioning for The Color Purple, I never expected to be in it, but I would have been happy just to carry his script, to carry water, to do anything to work with him. So I felt that it was something that the two of us would be interested in, that story of the family moving itself and being able to speak to not just what it means to be a family, but what it means to be a family of the world.
This experience of Oprah and I co-producing The 100-Foot Journey is for me a dream come true because it's the first time Oprah and I have worked together since 1985. Because all the times that I've done your show,
yes,
that's not working together.
No.
That's like being in your living room.
Yes.
That's like being a guest in your home.
Yes.
Do you even know this? That the reason why I owned myself, owned the Harpo Studios, had a studio to begin with, is because of my very first visit to Amblin in the summer of 1985, actually the spring of 1985. I just love the idea of this familial atmosphere of artists working together. That's where the seed was planted. It's because of you.
Well, I think that whole idea about working in a community of new acquaintances that the second they hit the ground feel like they're part of a family.
Yes.
An ongoing family. And that's the way most of the movies I've directed work, that it is a gypsy sort of court. And, you know, because we come into each other's lives, we spend emotionally intensive months together, many emotionally intensive months.
Yes.
And then before you know it, we go flying off like spores in the wind.
Right.
And that's what the whole community of movies does. And yet, as we go through life, there's always the people you remember that you want to stay in touch with, that you want to continue working with. And we had a chance to put our creative energies together in a very compatible way to find a way to tell this story about compatibility amongst people that you would never imagine could even be compatible, whether it's love or food. Just imagine Helen, Mirren playing Madame Mallory. I couldn't get that image out of my mind.
And he's Steven Spielberg, so he can get that to happen.
But I can, well, you can if the actor's available and if
yes.
they like the script.
Yes, but when I even heard that we're reaching out to Helen Mirren, I was like, okay, well, when, if you get Helen Mirren, you're on the way to getting a movie.
We get a serious movie now.
Yeah,
we got a serious movie. But a serious movie with a tremendous sense of humor, which is something the author brought to it, something that the casting and the cast brought to it, and it's certainly something that Lasse continued to...
Yeah. But he's seasoned throughout.
Yes, he seasoned it throughout. Charlotte Lebon was someone who I had seen, a French casting director, had just mentioned her name to us, but I went on YouTube and I saw a French daytime variety show where a couple days a week she would come out and do the weather.
Wow.
In outlandish costumes, sometimes painting her face gold or silver.
Wow.
And coming out with red fright wigs and coming out with a clown's nose. And she came out and did a comedy weather riff. And I realized anybody that beautiful, that can be that funny, you know, that is a souffle.
Yes.
And we had to get that souffle in That's the souffle.
Nice.
Manish very much is Om's son.
Yes.
There is something on camera and off camera that really bonded those two actors.
I think it's Om cooking every weekend and them sitting around the table and creating traditional Indian food.
Sure.
And being together as a family and as a father figure.
Right.
That really helped mesh that.
It did, and I think he learned a lot from him, how to prepare
yes.
some of the meals.
Particularly for this film, the food is another character, and we've made it so. The director did such an amazing job of making the food. Every time you look at a tomato, you think it's going to speak to you. Nobody can go to this film, may I say, and not come away and want to eat a really good meal afterwards.
Whenever I eat mashed potatoes, not exactly what you would call the au couture of cuisine.
No.
But whenever I eat mashed potatoes, and I can indulge myself and drench it in melted butter, it takes me back to being 7 and 8 years old, which is exactly how my mom made the mashed potatoes, right, next to her pot roast. That the mashed potatoes was like a volcano. She would actually take the mashed potatoes, stick them in the plate, smash down the top, ladle in the butter in the top. And we're not even talking about the gravy now. We're just talking about the butter.
Yeah.
And so that is, for me, that mouthful, that memory that just brings me right back home again.
They take you home.
Yeah.
It brings back a fondness and memories and a feeling of being nurtured and supported. It means every bite makes me think of being loved. So food plays a big role in bringing the family together. It's the central focus for that which allows them to stand out, because they feel a great sense of confidence in their ability to make wonderful food, and food that really fills people up spiritually, emotionally, as well as being delicious.
So many foods today are spoken of in terms of fusion. And there's so much fusion going on with global cuisine.
Yes.
And this really is a story about the sort of human fusion between two opposite cultures.
Yes.
And food is sort of the ambrosia that kind of draws them together and makes them understand that we're all really the same person.
Which is ultimately, for me, the best stories to tell, in which you can see that even though it's a different culture, even though it's different backgrounds, even though we believe different things, ultimately, we are all really more alike than we are different. And I think that's the 100-foot journey that everybody who steps up to that realization eventually takes. Do you agree?
I agree completely. I think you make your own home, and I think you can remake your own home many times during your lifetime. But I think in this case, they were looking for a place to sink their roots. At the very beginning, they have to leave their home country of India, and they have to find a place to sink their roots. And we don't show every country they travel to, but we infer that they've tried a number of countries before, almost on the whim of a ghost of the mother, of the wife, is able to
settle
there.
Yeah.
So like a tortoise, they carry their homes on their backs. And you just know at the conclusion of this movie that this is a good place for them for a while.
I
felt lush. And the ambience of that countryside, that amazing, you know, French countryside.
When I was there, it's like something you dreamed. I thought, how fantastic. You know, you're talking about creating a family, but how fantastic that the film family gets to actually work in that atmosphere.
Right.
And it wasn't, you know, just like a Hollywood backlot or something.
Right,
that it was the real deal.
Then when Lasse Hallström came on board to direct the picture, with his incredible knowledge and grasp of cinema.
Why did you want it to be him?
Well, for one thing, I still love, one of my favorite movies of all time is My Life as a Dog.
Ooh,
and
I have
been a fan of Lasse's from the beginning of his life as a filmmaker. Lasse is a stickler for the details. And what really turns him on as an artist, as a filmmaker, is finding those little asides that aren't central to the screenplay, but it's something that a child does in the background. It's a little smile that the younger brother gives to Hassan, his older brother.
Yes.
It's those little details that I knew that Lasse, from his other work, was going to pepper, if I can use a...
Yeah.
Although pepper is, you don't put pepper on everything.
But
he was going to season the movie with all these little sort of nuances and details, and was going to make the movie even more special than it was on the page.
My experience was, here's a director who is not just in control, but also loves the work and loves the people he's working with.
Yes.
Because he's created this sense of family and nurturing that supports the cast in a way that just makes everybody better. I mean, and just also what was going on behind the scenes, you know, everybody going to Umm's house and him cooking on the weekend and everybody gathering around the table. So food was a part of it, even when they weren't working.
Of course, we had food consultants on the set to show the actors. I was watching dailies every day, as Oprah was. And I was always terrified of the phone ringing to say that somebody lost the tip of a finger.
Yeah.
I had this horrible vision.
Really?
That during some of the cooking scenes.
Yes, that somebody's gonna.
Okay, the expert turns the knife over to the actor.
And there it is.
And the actor lops off a part of their finger. I mean, I lived in fear of this moment happening. On the last day of shooting, I was so relieved that never happened.
I could not believe that when I saw it, how emotional it was for me. I was thinking, okay, now you know, you've seen every daily, and now you're sitting here crying. Come on, Oprah. But I did.
It got to me emotionally big time when I first saw it. I was very, very moved. I was immediately looking for a phone to call Lasse, because I just wanted to reach out to Lasse and to Stephen Knight, who wrote the screenplay and also the author of the book, because I think it was just a beautiful handoff from book to script to director.
Yeah.
I was choked up when I talked to Lasse. When he heard my voice, I was a little bit undone by the end of the movie.
Because lots of movies you go to and you think, oh, well, the book was better. Da, da, yeah. Da. You don't feel that at all. You're right. It's a perfect handoff.
The book was,
the script was, and the movie is.
It really is a narrative, a very clear chapter one, then chapter two happens, yeah. Then here comes chapter three. We can't wait for chapter four.
Yeah.
And it peaks exactly where you hope it will,
yeah.
And it falls off exactly when you want it to. And then it's kind of old-fashioned in a good way.
Stephen, that's perfect. It's old-fashioned in a really good way.
In a good way, it's
old-fashioned. It's like a real movie that, you know, we used to get up and go to the movies and go see, that fills you up and you come out with a really great feeling and you want to tell your friends about it. Yeah. In a good way.
Anybody who gets out of a chair and makes some kind of an effort to walk across the street to meet someone that they've always wanted to meet or to say hello to someone they're afraid of, it takes effort to get out of your chair. And that 100-foot journey represents everything that we go through, whether it has to do with food, yeah, or love or children or friendship. You have to make an effort.
Yeah.
You have to walk a distance in order to achieve something of value for yourself.
Every 100-foot journey that anybody takes is really like the Wizard of Oz. It's never any further than your own backyard, because it has to happen here and here. The shift had to come here before he could walk across the street. So for everybody who makes the 100-foot journey, it all starts right here.